They'll never afford those. You know, they won't get the fancy ones, I can guarantee you that. But I'm pretty well convinced in a couple of years, it will be a new reg, and it'll just be the way it is. Just like when it started out with gloves in pericare, and gloves in bathing, and gloves in oral hygiene. It started out just not really optional, but it started out where some did, some didn't, and then pretty soon, bang, it became everybody has to. So I believe it's coming. Okay, chapter 14, page 241. Again, reviewing a little bit over the words here. Apathy, of course, is lack of interest, and you can truly understand how the residents can manifest apathy. After scratching the things off your list, you know, you may have even felt some emotions about loss, and you can really, really, really imagine from them, you know, what they would really go through and feel, because theirs wasn't a list on a piece of paper, theirs was in reality. Aspiration, of course, we've already talked about that a lot, and the trachea and the esophagus and the throat, that the trachea has to be covered over by the epiglottis. If it's not, if it's gotten slower, or if it's shrunk in size, stuff can get through it, get past the trachea before it closes, so therefore the thick liquids, so we slow the liquids down. So we give this flap a little bit more time to close. Or if it's shrunk in size, the thickened liquids provide more of a globule. So they won't go down. If there's a little sliver of an opening, they won't go down the sliver and the person won't choke.
It's usually just a little sliver, right? I mean, if it's getting bigger than that, they'll probably get feeding to, right?
Yeah. If they opt for it. We've had some people that have refused thickened liquids and refused a feeding tube. And what we had to do was get with the legal department, have a document drawn up that basically stated they knew the risk of thin liquids, they were educated in what those risks were, but still, with that knowledge, it was still their choice to have thin liquids, even though that those thin liquids would probably cause them respiratory distress, aspiration pneumonia, or possibly even death. So,
because what if people are confused? Is the parent, the family, or
okay? Now, here you're getting into legal stuff, because if they're confused, and these legal papers we talked about. They don't have a living will, they don't have a durable power of attorney, they don't have an advanced care health directive. It's too late to get them once they're confused. The only option then is going to the court and getting court appointed guardianship, where the family would have to get a lawyer, go prove incompetency for the resident, and then one or more of the family or friends or somebody become the person's guardian. And then the guardian then is that person that they can sign legal paperwork. But if the other stuff hasn't been done, once a person gets confused, they cannot do an advanced care health directive anymore, they cannot do a durable power attorney, they cannot do any of that stuff anymore. All that can be done is a guardianship case. Dehydration, we talked about that, and basically if there's not enough fluid in the body, simply the body will not work right. One of the things that can happen is a dehydration fever. People get fevers because of dehydration. It's simply the same principle. If you don't put the coolant, the liquid, in your car radiator, what's going to happen to your car? It's going to overheat. The same thing with the human body. If a person is not drinking enough liquids, one of the things that they will do is overheat or a fever. Dietary cards, we're going to look at some of them. Diuretics. Now, a lot of your folks take diuretics. Diuretics are medicines to get extra fluid out of their body. Like when I talked to you about the fluid buildup in the lungs or the fluid buildup around the heart. Well, that fluid has to be gotten out of the body, and what the people take is a diuretic. Well, and see, how the diuretic works is this way. It pulls sodium out of the body. Most diuretics, they pull sodium out of the body, and water follows sodium. So, and that's basically as simply how the diuretic works. But sometimes too much water gets pulled out because of the diuretic, and people can get dehydrated. Now, one of the things that you're going to need to know is, you know, if your residents get a diuretic from the medication aid, you kind of need to know that, because if they give them something, you need to know that within a half an hour to an hour, they're going to be hitting that call light because their bladder is going to be full and they're going to be needing to go to the bathroom. And especially if they give them a little bit extra, because maybe they are having some of this fluid buildup, you got to know to watch that light or keep track of them or go check on them, because some of this stuff, this diuretics, when it hits like lightning. They can like be there sitting and everything fine, and it's like a feeling like this. Whoosh, all of a sudden your bladder fills. And people will risk their safety not waiting for you to come to help them, because of the fear of embarrassment, the fear of being making fun of. They don't want to be incontinent, so they will risk their own safety and try to make it to the bathroom themselves instead of pushing the call light and wait for you to come. So if they're taking diuretics, you basically need to know.
Isn't that pretty common though in elderly? Because they, you know, just, I mean, my mom's on the nursing home, but she has problems with it. When it hits, she's got to go. It's yeah. Jacking around. Don't take 10 minutes to get to me. I got to go now.
Yeah, it hits like lightning. Like I said, 1 minute they're sitting there, and it's the whoosh, whoosh, just she's like in better. 30 seconds. You know, it's like your bladder's full. And I, because I take a very strong diuretic, and that's exactly how I feel. It's like I'm fine, and then like in 30 seconds, it's like somebody dumped a gallon of water in my bladder or something. It's just a feeling of urgency. It's a feeling of being full. And I'm not sure if it's how the medicine works, you know, and it pulls off a lot all at once, but it literally feels like in 30 seconds, my bladder's full. And it's tough sometimes, because if you're driving your car, or you're here, or you're a resident in the wheelchair, you know, and what's really even tough is if a resident's in their chair in their room and we forgot to give them their call light, you know, and in their favorite chair that was given to them by their children, we forgot to put a pad in the chair, now they're about ready to be incontinent, and in this beautiful lazy boy, they're about to make it wet with their urine. So what they will do is they will get up on their own and try to go to the bathroom because they don't want to destroy this chair that was a gift from their children. And of course, then they get up, they fall. They break a hip. And then like I told you before, you know, how many people die within 21 days after a broken hip? And that's because of, like I said, we make new blood every 21 days. Well, they've lost one third of that capability, and it's just too much of a shock to them, and they just can't recover. So we've got to know the folks on diuretics. Dysphagia is the difficulty swallowing. Now, edema is extra fluid in the tissue in the skin. Most of the time, like what I said, the fluid will back up to the lungs, be back up to the heart. Most of the time before it does that though, you are going to see their feet a little bit puffy, or maybe a lot puffy. So before it it backs up to the heart or the lungs, somebody should have been seeing puffy feet. And we can, it's easier to help them at the puffy feet stage than it is at the fluid in the lung stage. So if you see edema, and like sometimes you just press the top of their foot and you'll press it and the indentation of a light finger touch will stay in there for a couple seconds. If it does that, that's not good. They got a lot of fluid. And the reason why people are backing up fluid is because the heart is not beating as strong as it should or normally would. So as it beats weaker, the fluid is backing up. That's why it backs up to the tissue and stuff like that. Fluid balance, we kind of talked about that a little bit with the I and O already, that usually, for the most part, it's pretty well equal, you know, in a 24-hour period. If the person takes in about 2,000 milliliters, they put out about, you know, 1,500. Now, where did the other 500 go? Well, it's called indispensable water loss, unmeasurable. What it is when we breathe out or when we talk, we are breathing out water. We are breathing out humidity. In the winter, of course, you go out and you see your breath. Well, what it is the water crystals that you're breathing out. We breathe out about 1 to 2 ounces in an hour. So if that's like a 12 ounce, what is that? 16, what is that water thing by? How many ounces is that?
20.
So around approximately 10 hours, what we breathe out could fill that glass container, whatever it is, bottle. And so that's where the difference is. Now, if the difference is really spread apart, 2,000 in, 500 out, now that means that they're starting to retain fluid somewhere. And at that point, we got to get concerned, because if that goes on another day, another day, another day, it could get out of hand. So taking somebody's INO is like an early warning to warn us, okay, something changes going on here, we better watch them. Some people will get fluid overload, and that is like what I'm talking about with the feet being swollen, and then it backs up all the way to the heart or to the lungs. Force fluids, now really, FF is the abbreviation, but it really should say frequent fluids. We're going away from the word force fluids, and we're going to frequent fluids because of the connotation of force. But what it is giving more than the usual amounts. This is where somebody is, if the nurse tells you to frequent fluid somebody, push fluids on one of your residents, that means they're concerned about dehydration, and we have to encourage them several times all through our shift. Now, George, take a couple sips of water. Take more sips of water. Most people don't drink enough water, and water makes our body work. Remember when we studied the six essential nutrients? What was the number one? What was the most important nutrient? Water. Water is the number one. Glucose, of course, is sugar. A graduate is a measuring container. Input, output, we've talked about that and how we measure it. Remember, we measure in milliliters. Now, somebody may say cc's, cubic centimeters. Don't let it throw you off, because a milliliter and a cubic centimeter are the exact same. They're synonymous. So some people may say they drank 200 milliliters. Another person may say, no, they didn't, they drank 200 cc's. They're both saying the same thing, okay? Malnutrition, of course, what that is the person is just not eating enough. Metabolism is the process that where nutrients are broken down in the gut for energy. And of course, this, when we talk about Alzheimer's, this is one of the things that the body literally forgets how to do. Remember, Alzheimer's is a series of forgetting, four stages, and in stage number four, the body's forgetting how to work. And one of the things is the gut forgets how to work. So actually, in some Alzheimer's patients, not all, but in some, you could actually, when they have a bowel movement, you could find a lot of undigested food, a lot of whole foods, because the gut has forgotten how to break down that food and how to metabolize it. So it goes all the way through the system, all the way through the GI system, virtually untouched sometimes. A lot of times with Alzheimer's people, their BMs will be more mushy-mushy, if that's a word. The reason why it's more mushy-mushy is because it's got a lot of fat in it. Because again, the fat's not been broken down, it hasn't been, it stayed in the food, and it basically made the BM be more soft. Nutrient, of course, that is the source of our energy and our metabolism and nutrition. Output, we talked about pureed. We'll talk about that when we talk about the diets. Restricted fluids. Now, once in a while, a person will be on restricted fluids. This is where they can't drink too much. Where maybe, like, all they're allowed to drink in 24 hours is one of these bottles of water. That's all their milk, their coffee, their juice, includes the water they take with their pills, the water. Can you imagine trying to spread that in liquid through breakfast, lunch, and dinner? And then you gotta take into account some of the foods that have water in them. Watermelon, you know, high content water. So if somebody's on restricted fluid, that tells you that they are a really high risk for fluid overload. Because if they get too much fluid in them, they are going to get the people that, where I drew those pictures with the lungs filling up with water or the heart encompassed by water, they're going to be the people that basically have those problems. We're going to be looking at special diets. One of those, of course, is vegetarian. We do have, you know, folks that are vegetarian. I didn't know this until my daughter told me this, that there are different levels of vegetarianism. Mild, a little bit, more moderate, and then more complete. So here again, it comes down to basically knowing our residents, knowing their likes, knowing their dislikes. And when we talk about these dietary cards, and there's a picture of them on 247, you know, this is where information like that has to be. And if that information is not there, we could accidentally insult someone. Like, say, bring a person, like who's Jewish, a pork burger. Or bring a person that has a really delicate stomach some hot, spicy food that they're having. Maybe they're having tacos and enchiladas and burritos tonight for supper, and they're kicked up a little bit spicy. Well, they've got a really delicate stomach, and you know that could be made. Maybe somebody has a milk allergy, and we're bringing them some pudding that was made with milk. So those dietary cards are really important. It's just as the dietary cards in some aspect are just important as the medication card. Just like you know, you got to look at the medication for a person, you're going to make a mistake and somebody's going to get hurt. But it's the same thing with the dietary card. We got to look at it or somebody's going to get hurt, either physically or emotionally. Because some people on their dietary cards, they will say they want a glass of tomato juice at every meal. And in one day we'll bring them their tray and the tomato juice will not be on there, and it will upset them so much they may say stuff like, you don't care for me. All I ask is for one simple thing, a glass of tomato juice, and you guys don't care for me at all. You can't even remember my tomato juice. You know, you just don't care. And, you know, it could really upset them that much. So looking at that dietary card as we're bringing the tray out, and if we're looking at it and it don't gel, we got to make a U-turn before we get to the resident and get for them basically what's on their dietary card. Food is a social time. Again, we are with residents. You know, in their generation, the meal time was a time when the kids gathered around the table, mom and dad were there, how was your day, what's going on, updates, talk about different stuff, plan different stuff they're going to do. You know, it was. Now today, it's not that way. You know, if you know, you got children or whatever, you know, I mean, kind of think, you know, how many meals do we really have, you know, really all together? So the meal time for the resident in a nursing home is like a sacred time. And the dining room is a sacred place to a certain extent, because we are allowed only to do certain things in that dining room. If a nurse gives a resident a shot in the dining room, it best be a life-saving shot, you know, really, because they're supposed to take them out of the dining room, bring them to a private area, and then do it. You know, only medication that can virtually be given in the dining room is basically pills. You know, but we're not supposed to be doing treatments in there. We're not supposed to be giving shots in there. We're supposed to be doing as little as possible to disrupt that meal. Because a lot of your residents' meal time is literally going to be the highlight of their day. Because that's the time when they get out of their room, when they get to see other residents, when they get to visit, have fun, maybe laugh, move around, get in some sunshine, who knows what else. But it's a time when they get out of that cave. The room sometimes can become a cave. And it is the highlight of their day. So we've got to be extremely careful to protect that highlight. The delivery of food and how we deliver food and how we present it is incredibly important. It has to look good. If you're going to go to a restaurant and pay good money and they are constantly going to come like this, okay, here's your food, you know, and maybe we may not throw it like that down in front of the resident, but sometimes the way we plan it down there is just about like that, or they have mixed your